we have light? Do we have power? Do we have action? Okay, good. Got to get back into the groove of things here. It's good to be home. We were on the adventure to Newfoundland, as everybody knows, and everybody knows about the ship that almost sank, the MV Holiday Island. Yes, that is the ferry we took to Prince Edward Island on Monday, and we were not on the boat on Friday when the fire in the engine room threatened to sink the ship, and all hands abandoned ship. They got all the crew and passengers off. So 96 cars trapped on board. I'm glad our camper isn't still on that boat. But that the wonderful work done by the crew is I've been on those boats. That's a big job, getting hundreds of people off of one of those boats and safely without anything but a few bruises and minor scrapes from sliding it down a three-story slide into a floating bouncy castle. But after seeing the size of these boats and what it takes to manage that, and it's certainly increases one's appreciation for what our transport people do for us and keeping us safe. It's good to be home. It was a great adventure. And there's always got to be disasters like brakes failing and stuff like that to make the story interesting. But that's just the spice. You will notice in our announcements there's a lot going on. So make sure you carefully look at everything in your bulletin, because there's a lot of things happening. One thing in particular, if you come here at 9:30 next Sunday, you're going to find it's really quiet and the doors will probably be locked and you'll be wondering where everybody is. Well, just turn your vehicle south, drive down the gravel road, follow the signs to Narana, because we're having a joint service, our annual joint service out at Narana next Sunday at 10:30. So if you come here at 9:30, you got plenty of time to get there on time. You've lost all your excuses. So there's a shower coming up on August the 12th and for Alana, and there's lots of exciting things going on in the church, and we're getting geared up for the end of the quiet summer season and into our busy season of fall. I will also just note the Country Gospel CLWR fundraising concert. If you haven't gotten your tickets yet, get them. It's going to be a fun time, and I'm planning on playing this guitar, so you get a foretaste of the instrument that one of the instruments I'll be using for that with our little local group that we have yet to come up with a solid name for. We are still thinking about what to call our church's country gospel group, although the name Cow Patties seems to be in the front running. So that is all the more reason for you to come up with your brilliant and devout suggestions. Are there announcements that didn't make it into the bulletins? Anything urgent that we need to highlight before we begin? Nope. We are using our service of the word from the ELW this morning is our order of service, and we're going to be doing lots of singing. So our opening hymn, number 681. Plow the fields and scatter
on the land, but it is there and watered by God's almighty hand, who sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sun. Refreshing.
grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Together in the prayer of the day, let us pray. Benevolent God, you are the source, the guide, and the goal of our lives. Teach us to love what is worth loving, to reject what is offensive to you, and to treasure what is precious in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we hear our first lesson.
Morning. The first lesson is from Ecclesiastes, various verses. Vanity of vanities, says the teacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. I, the teacher, was king over Israel in Jerusalem. I applied my mind to seek and to search out by wisdom all that is done under heaven. It is an unhappy business that God has given to humans to be busy with. I saw all the deeds that are done under the sun, and see, all is vanity and a chasing after wind. I hated all my toil in which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to my successor, and who knows whether he will be wise or foolish. Yet he will be master of all which I toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This also is vanity. So I turned and gave my heart up to despair concerning all the toils of my labors under the sun, because sometimes one who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What do mortals get from all the toil and strain with which they toil under the sun? For all their days are full of pain, and their work is a vexation. Even at night, their minds do not rest. This also is vanity. The psalm for this morning is Psalm 49, verses 1 to 12, and I ask the congregation to respond with the indented portions. Hear this, all you peoples.
Hear, all you who dwell in the world.
You of high degree and low.
Rich and poor together.
My mouth shall speak of wisdom.
And my heart shall meditate on understanding.
I will incline my ear to a proverb.
And set forth my riddle upon the harp.
Why should I be afraid in evil days? The wickedness of those who trust in their own prowess.
And boast of their great riches.
One can never redeem another.
Or give to God the ransom for another's life.
For the ransom of a life is so great
that there will never be enough to pay it.
In order to live forever and ever,
and never see the grave,
for we shall that the wise die also, for we see that the wise die also, like the dull and stupid, they perish.
And leave their wealth to those who come after them.
Their graves shall be their homes forever, their dwelling places from generation to generation.
Though they have gained lands after themselves.
Even though honored, they cannot live forever.
They are like
the epistle lessons is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 to 11. For if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all such things: anger, malice, wrath, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourselves with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, enslaved and free, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
Turn to hymn number 793. Remain standing for our gospel acclamation. For today, the eighth Sunday after Pentecost, is taken from the Gospel of Luke, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus was teaching, and someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But Jesus said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." And he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things that you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich towards God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. This is the time-honored warning, isn't it? We've seen and heard this many times. But we also continue to hear an opposite gospel. The gospel of the empire of our world. Our world that is built on trade and profit and on the whole dream of success as we are taught to see it. All of our gospel, all of our messages, all our readings, including the psalm, have a very consistent message this Sunday. They all talk about this very illusion, this thing that is sold to us, this vision of how the world works. And you know, it has a really strong surface appeal and an incredibly powerful cultural pull. This message that success is something that you can measure with a calculator or a slide rule or an abacus or a spreadsheet. That success is the amount of stuff that we can point to and say, that's my pile and you can't touch it. And that shows that I matter. It's not a new thing. Our culture is not uniquely focused on gain and on profit and on success measured in monetary terms. It's been around a very long time. In fact, much longer even than the time of Jesus when the Roman Empire was so dominant. We look at our first lesson. The traditional, it doesn't really say in the book who was the writer of Ecclesiastes, the preacher. But here in this lesson, we see pretty clearly who it's meant to be from. The one who was king in Israel, the great teacher of wisdom, Solomon. And we know the story of Solomon. As the Sunday school child said, he had 700 wives and 300 porcupines. He had tremendous wealth. And we're told that in the days of Solomon, there was so much gold in the city of Jerusalem that silver was considered to be really not worth much. It was kind of, just silver. There was so much wealth. The kingdom of David had been established. There was peace on every side, and Solomon was able to build this incredible trade network and to profit off of the fact that Israel is at a major trade crossroads. Everything going from Egypt to the Fertile Crescent in the northeast has to pass through Israel. Anything passing from Europe through into Asia has to go through Israel. It's the crossroads of the world. At the time, it was literally the crossroads of the known world. It was at the navel of the great empire of Rome. So Solomon was secure and safe. His borders were solid. His neighbors had been pacified. There were no threats to Jerusalem. There were no threats of invasion. Peace had been achieved. And with peace comes profit. But with profit, all too quickly comes exploitation. And what did Solomon do with the security and safety of Israel? He built himself a spectacular palace. And he built the very spectacular temple. But the palace was built first. The temple came after Solomon's big, impressive house and his huge throne were built. At the end of his life, we have the story of what happens to Solomon. Solomon is seduced by his own wealth. He fell into following the false gods of the many, many marriages of convenience that helped secure that kingdom. He lost his soul. He lost his connection to his God. And as a result, in spite of being the most successful person in the world at his time, the richest monarch, one of the richest monarchs perhaps ever to have reigned, he found it vanity of vanities. All is vanity. It's all empty and like chasing after the wind. He felt he had wasted his life. How tragic. See, I worked all this, I accomplished all of this, and the one who comes after me, I don't even know if he's going to be an idiot. And you know what? It was exactly that happened. Solomon's sons were idiots. They began squabbling over the great wealth and power that their father had bequeathed them, and they blew it all. The kingdom was divided, and because it was divided, it was easily conquered. And everything was thrown back to the wind. And he might as well have been chasing the wind to start with. Paul also in the same boat. And he wants to teach wisdom. So the psalmist sets this tune to the music of the harp. And his great point is, why should I fear in times of trouble when the iniquity of my persecutors surround me, those who trust in their wealth? The ones who don't build relationships, but rather build piles of stuff and put their security there. Those who boast in the abundance of their riches. Because why? It doesn't make you alive. No ransom avails for one's life. You can't buy your life with stuff. You can only live your life with or without the joy that you find in it. There is no price one can give to God to keep you alive. We all end up leaving this world. And what do we leave behind? Do we leave a big pile of stuff for others to fight over? Or do we leave behind the love that is in the hearts of those that we have enhanced, grown relationships with, and helped each other to love each other? Yesterday was quite a busy day for me. And I think most people are aware that we had two burials. We had two families gather to lay to rest the ashes of their loved ones. In each case, nobody was talking about how much money they made. Nobody was talking about the tremendous decorating that they'd done in the house and the thing that they left behind that looked so impressive, or the tremendous amount of goods that they passed on. Really not interesting. What people talked about was the relationship that they had with this departed loved one. Not only that, but the relationship that their grief celebrates. I mentioned to a couple of people yesterday that the saddest funerals I've ever seen are where nobody cries, where there is no grief over the loss of someone. That to me speaks of a life entirely wasted. The grief that is evident when we leave shows the love that is still there. The psalmist says, when we look at the wise, they die. Fool and the dolt perish together and leave their wealth to others. Their graves are their homes forever, their dwelling places to all generations. Yeah, a little crude, but very, very true. Though they named lands after themselves, mortals cannot abide in their pomp. They are like the animals in that they perish. But what we do have is the opportunity to pour our lives into each other and enhance the life and the joy and the experience of those around us. And when we do that, God is present, bringing real life to be. So Jesus finally tells this story and so clearly illustrates that it does not matter one whit how big the pile is, how impressive the structures, how huge the bank account. Don Henley, the great philosopher and lead singer with the Eagles, pointed out that you don't see no hearses with luggage racks. But what you do see is the hearts of those left behind, those who were touched and moved and inspired. Did we inspire somebody today? Did we touch somebody with a tender touch and show our appreciation? That's where true treasure is. That is the wealth that will endure even when we are gone. We don't want to end up like Solomon at the end of his days, saying, everything I've poured my life into is a waste. No. Much better to look back at our lives and say, yeah, there was a lot of opportunities perhaps that I missed. There were a lot of things I could have done that I didn't do, maybe. But I sure loved the people around me. And I sure enjoyed being loved by those around me. And when we do that, we leave a legacy, a real legacy. We have our hymn of the day coming up, number 705, God of Grace and God of Glory. And I want us to pay attention to the words of that song because it's sometimes really badly misused. And it can be heard as a triumphant hymn about how God is so glorious and we are glorious for following God and that everything is great and wonderful. But I think we need to look a little carefully, more carefully at the words and listen to what it's saying and say, see how it proclaims us small and weak and insignificant in all the ways that the world wants us to be big and powerful and significant, but that God's grace and God's glory is in the small things, the weak things, the vulnerable things, the things that die. And in those things, we find true grace. And we are blessed beyond all measure. So let's turn to hymn number 705, God of Grace and God of Glory.
Thank you.
Together confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God and for all people in Christ's name. We give you thanks, O Lord God, that you have come to us in the small and the weak and the apparently insignificant, and told us who are small and weak and apparently insignificant that we are, in your eyes, so important and so beloved. We thank you that you continue to come in the small events, in the weak things, in the vulnerable things, and proclaim your power through weakness. You proclaim your life even in your death, and you call us to love and to give and to share with one another the true power, the true joy, and the true life that is in you. Lord, in your mercy. We ask you to continue to inspire, strengthen, and send servants into the world to proclaim the gospel of your coming, your dying, your resurrection. Help us to support all of those who proclaim this gospel of joy and hope everywhere. Help us to be good supporters of one another as we proclaim this life. And bless all who work for the betterment of humanity because of your call of love and care. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
we recognize that we live in a world that still experiences tremendous brokenness. We ask for grace and mercy for those in areas of war and conflict, that peace may be given a chance, that those who are oppressed may be set free, that those who are afraid may be able to live in confidence and peace, knowing that they are secure. Raise up and lift up leaders who work for the benefit of the vulnerable and the weak, so that all may experience your grace, Lord, in your mercy. We recognize, O Lord, that we all are subject to the way of this universe, which is death and resurrection. Therefore, we must all deal with the reality of death. We ask your comfort, your strength, and your courage to all families who grieve. Be with us as we mourn, and help us to comfort one another with the hope of your joy and with the presence that you have given us to share with one another. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our. We lift up before you all of those in, around, and among us who are struggling this time or who are in need of care. We pray for those who are ill, that the healing hands that you have around them might be strengthened and inspired. We pray for those in our nursing homes. We pray for Edna and Doris, Kathleen, Ted, Irene, Christine, Evelyn, Loretta, Pauline. And we name before you with our words and in our hearts all of those whom we are concerned about. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks for the great cloud of witnesses that surrounds us, reminding us that we too will join them someday, that they are with us as we remember, and we are not alone. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. Live long and prosper. Share a sign of peace with one another as is appropriate. At this time, we would traditionally receive offering through the offering plates, but we're still not doing that. The plates are at the back if you need to use them. And for those joining us via the internet, if you wish to make a contribution, there are opportunities. There are links at stjohnnirvana.com on the website. Thank you for your participation and for your contributions. You are part of this ministry, and whether you are able to contribute at this time or not, thank you for all those who have supported us through this time of especially the time when we were online only. We continue with our offertory. We lift our voices.
Oh,
Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word, you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory forever. Amen. Let us join in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please stand for the blessing. May the Lord, who brought our Savior Jesus Christ back from death to life, bring us to new life in joy in his name and in love towards one another and in our touch towards the world. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We turn to our closing hymn, number 542.
Thank you.
peace, serve the Lord.